Here we go. That work? All right. So I kind of compiled a lot in today's lesson. We're going to go over business filings, contracts, and then storage and backing up photos. Okay. This is obviously like I am not, I feel like I have to like disclose this. I am not a practicing accountant any longer, and I'm not a lawyer. So in order to get professional opinions, you should contact someone in that field. Okay, but on the other side of that, I have been an accountant and I do know as from running my own business some of the things that you do need to do. But you know what? Look into it yourself as well. There's my disclosure. Oops. All right, how do we get to the next slide? There we go. We're gonna start with the quote. I don't even know this word, guys, but I just like the rest of the quote. It is an immutable law in business that words are words, explanations are explanations, promises are promises, but only performance is reality. As we talk about contracts today, keep it in mind that, like, if you don't know your contract, your client won't know your contract. The only thing that they're going to base their opinion on is your performance. So when it really comes down to it, the contract is here to save your butt in case it's needed, but the client really only cares about the performance. They're probably not even going to read the contract, which is so sad. But anyways, so just keep that in mind. Overview. First, we're going to start with business filings with the state. Second, important tax information and things that you should be doing year round to make sure you're set up and ready to file taxes. Because you have to file taxes if you make over $600. So keep that in mind. And that's too, if like with a W-2, if you work for someone else, they're going to give you a W-2. When you work for yourself, you don't get a W-2. You have to keep records of everything for your taxes. Number three, the importance of contracts, what to include in contracts, and then we'll talk about backing up files and storage after that. Business filings first. So technically, I started my LLC. Let's see, was it 2 years ago? I started an LLC. And in order to file an actual business, you have to go to the Secretary of State for your state. So if you wanted to register in Minnesota, you'd go to Minnesota State Secretary of State website. When I move back to South Dakota, I will transfer my LLC back to South Dakota. So I'll have to go to the Secretary of State's website in South Dakota. So each state has their own website. I'm going to show you guys Minnesota's. We'll go here quick. If you aren't filed, so you don't have a business filing, but you are making money, you're what is called a sole proprietor. Okay. So you're not registered. Let's say that you're not a registered business, but you're making money. So it's what it's called a sole proprietor. You'll still have to report that income on your taxes when it comes to April the next year. But there are some benefits of registering as an LLC or a different form of business structure. I am going to mostly talk about an LLC because I think it's probably the easiest one and best one for photographers. Maybe someone will fight me on it, but we'll go just go from here. Okay, so this is the Secretary of State for Minnesota. If you want to start a business, and they make it as easy as this. Start a business. You click here. It'll tell you everything you need to know: how to register your business, how to search business filings, how to order copies and certificates. And it's a lot of reading. Basically, what you're going to do is you're going to fill out a piece of paper about who's the president. So Anna Baiting, in my case, what's the name of your business? Anna Baiting Photography, and write a check for like $300. And there you go. You have an LLC. Okay. So I'm just going to show you here business filings online. Once you do that, hold on. Oh, there we go. Once you originally have an original file date, you'll then show up in the database on the website. So we'll look mine here. I'm registered as an LLC and I registered 1/26 of 2021. So I guess only a year and a half. Filing history. This was the original date that I filed. Oops, right here. Right here is the original date I filed. And then I registered as AB Photography at first, but I wanted to make a name change. So in December, I made a main ch name change to Anna Baiting Photography. So that's what it is now. I had to send in another check or whatever to make it official. You also have to do a yearly renewal. It's the stupidest thing. You have to log into your account, renew it. I think it's free. I know it's free, actually, but you have to do it every year to keep your business in good standing. Okay. So usually I do this while I'm doing my taxes. Just another one of those things that I try to remind myself to do is like, okay, go do my business filings yearly. If you're a sole proprietor, you haven't registered, obviously you don't have one of these accounts, you don't have to do a yearly renewal, but something once you do register for as a business, you'll have to do a yearly renewal. Otherwise your business just goes out of an active status like here, and you'll have to pay the $300 again to register for an LLC. So don't want to do that. Okay. So let's go back here. There we go. Original filing, amendments, your renewals. I just walked you through that. Okay. Business entity. So I talked a little bit about a sole proprietorship. That's what you are like right now. If you just decide to start making stickers and sell stickers. Okay. You're just what's called a sole proprietor. You just put it on your tax form as extra income, basically. You can also do this as a general partnership. If there's two or more people that started this business, they kind of go in the same grouping here. C-Corp or an S-Corp, there's a lot of different rules here that go into C-Corps and S-Corps. A lot of the times in S-Corp, you have to be under 100 employees. I do remember that. But a C-Corp is like your big corporations, okay? Not really realistic for photography. And there's a lot of fees and stuff that go into these ones, especially when it comes to taxes. So don't recommend. I do recommend an LLC. This is for a sole entrepreneur. Can you guys hear me? Hello? You can hear me? Okay, I just got a notification that my internet is unstable. So if you can't hear me, just wave. All right. So a limited partnership is if, or an LP is if there was two or more people creating basically an LLC. So as a sole proprietor, you're going to do an LLC. A lot of people have LLCs. It's easy to register, just like I showed you. The benefit of an LLC over a sole proprietorship and why I think it's so important to know this and to register as an LLC, which makes that $300 payment worth it, is that you no longer have liability over all your personal assets. So for me, I own my house, right? Me and my husband own my house. The business doesn't own my house. So if someone were to sue me, they could only sue me for my business property and not my personal property because I am registered under an LLC. If you were working as a sole proprietor, they could go after everything. They could take your car, your house, your personal savings, all of it. Okay. So that's why it's benefit to have an LLC and be legal. And it's super easy to file their taxes as an LLC. It still goes, it's called a flow-through entity. So it's still going to go straight onto your tax forms and you don't have to file a separate business tax form. Yeah, fun stuff. Okay, I better hurry up here. Whew. Other important business reminders. Insurance, it's really a good idea to look into insurance once you start getting really serious in your business. So you want to have liability insurance, which means if grandma was to roll an ankle because I told her to back up too far and she fell off a cliff, that's terrible. But if something like that were to happen and the family were to sue me, I would have insurance to cover my butt in case of lawsuits or whatever. And then also asset protections, like all my cameras, my computer, everything that I own for my business can be protected by insurance. So if I were to break it, I would just have to pay my deductible and then they would pay me whatever over the cost was for that to get it fixed. All right. The next thing is sales tax license. In Minnesota, if you're selling a service, you don't have to pay sales tax. However, if I was to also sell an album, like a photo album with the gallery or wedding or whatever, I'd have to charge sales tax on the album. So in Minnesota, that's the only way that I have to pay sales tax. In South Dakota, I have to pay sales tax on everything. Okay. So even services that I provide, if there's no product with it, I still have to pay sales tax in South Dakota. And it's a state by state basis. I'm not really sure what it is in Iowa. You'd have to look that up or call the Department of Revenue. To get set up with a sales tax license, you call the Department of Revenue. So I would just type in Minnesota Department of Revenue, call them up, ask them all kinds of questions. Like, what do I need to charge sales tax? How often do I need to file? I file quarterly. Some people have to file monthly, but you probably wouldn't have to. Some people even file yearly, I think, but quarterly is a little bit easier. So then you just like pay in what you have to. So every quarter I go through and, you know, pay all the sales tax that people have given me. Okay. Then accounting and tax preparation. If you don't know what you're doing, I would just highly recommend hiring someone. It's a business expense that most people have to pay. If not, they have someone on staff that does it for them, basically, or they just hire it out. So I would say probably, you know, in your first couple of years, I would just get a good accountant to help you out in that area to help keep track of your expenses and everything. So important tax info. This is what you can do, though, without an accountant that you'll have to do. You have to save your expense receipt. So anything that you buy, for example, if I'm buying a meal with a client, I'm going to save a receipt from that because I can write that off or a portion of it on my taxes. If I buy a new lens, I'm going to obviously keep that. How you classify it is a little bit different, but that you can leave up to your accountant. If it's over a certain dollar amount, you can depreciate it, which is way over our heads, okay? But most of the time it's under the certain amount, you can just write it off every year. But keep your receipts, because if the IRS comes back and says, what is this $2,000 charge for a Sony A7R3? You can be like, here's my receipt. I promise I bought it, right? The worst thing would be to get audited, but you do have to save your receipts and track your income and how they paid you. One of the things the IRS does ask is if they paid in cash, check, or credit card. So make sure you kind of keep that in check too as well. Easiest way to do this, HoneyBook tells you all this stuff. If you use HoneyBook, which is the client management software, I also keep track of it in QuickBooks, but that's also because I do my own accounting. So you can also submit all this stuff to an accountant, that kind of thing. Okay, track miles. I use Mile IQ, which is an app on my phone, which tracks every time I get into the car, how many miles I'm driving from start to finish. And then I just classify them as business or personal expense. Because I use my car for both, I have to track my miles. And the IRS is really strict about this. You have to track your miles. If you don't track your miles, you don't get any reimbursement. And you really want to, because I feel like last year it was like thousands of dollars that got deducted because of that I tracked my miles. Some people just use a spreadsheet. So like to Alex and Jaden's wedding, I went 204 miles or whatever. Then they could just keep that on the date in a spreadsheet. But I like to use my IQ. It's cheap. It's easy. And it tracks it for me. And I do it like once a year. It's terrible because I'm really bad at keeping up a spreadsheet. Okay. Then you pay sales tax. We talked about that. Usually quarterly. Don't forget to do that. Otherwise the IRS will come get you. All right. Let's talk about contracts. Two resources that I would highly suggest looking up for photographers, the Legal Page and LawTalk, especially the LawTalk. LawTalk is run by a lawyer who is also a photographer, and she's created all these contracts that you can buy. They are expensive, but they are completely worth it because you know that it's written by a lawyer, it's reviewed by a lawyer, so your contract is going to be safe, okay? For example, this is what's in my wedding contract. Ready? Here we go. Definitions, which is like, who is the client and who is the photographer? That's defining who is who. Services, what am I providing? What are they going to receive? Booking and payment, how do they book me and when is payment due? Consultation and requests, so how am I going to fulfill like a pre-planning meeting? If they have additional requests, how are those handled? Cancellation, failure to perform. That's pretty, you know, self-explanatory. Exclusivity. This one is they can't hire another photographer to be there while I'm there. So they can't just like be like, I'm going to hire another photographer just so I have double coverage, right? If you're hiring me, I want them to trust me so that I'm the sole photographer. Intellectual property and creative license. Basically, a creative license means everyone sees photography different. Everyone edits different. Every scenario is different. So I have the creativity and the creative license to see how to do what I see is fit. Okay. Obviously there's a lot of legal jargon. Safe working environment. This one is huge, you guys. Huge, huge, huge. I've almost had to leave weddings because of sexual harassment, and you want to make sure you're covered here because it's never the couple's fault. It's always a drunk groomsman or a drunk uncle who's going to have to make you use this clause, and you want to make sure you're covered. So standard list price. So if they want to add something, basically you have to refer to a standard list price, meals and breaks, completion schedule, when are you going to get them done, how long do they have before you archive them and you're hands free of them, of the photos, what happens if travels and overages are incurred, client usage of images, the venue guidelines. They have to basically communicate to you if there's any guidelines of their venues. For example, a Catholic church, sometimes they don't let you move around. So they need to let you know of that and that we are restricted by what the venue will allow us to do. General model release. You want to make sure that they know that you are going to share the images and they're okay with you sharing the photos. And a limit of liability. You can only sue me for up to the dollar amount of this like project. Okay, that's the limit of my liability. Oh, should have got water. Indemnification, severability, miscellaneous, notice, and then signatures. These are all very much legal jargon that no one really knows what's happening, but you basically all contracts have them. So that's a wedding contract. That's a lot. So at a minimum, here's what I think that you need. Definitions, define who the contract is with. Agreement, so your agreement details and services, what are you providing, what can they expect, booking and payment, how do they book you, and what is the payment schedule, cancellation, what happens if they cancel or if you fail to perform the services, a copyright, and a model release, so they know that you own the photos, that they're releasing them to be able to be used, how you see fit, limits of liability, when you can archive them, a harassment clause, and make sure they sign them. Okay. That's at a minimum. Excuse me. All right. So let's talk about storage and backing up your photos now that we got all the legal stuff out of the way. I always say if it's not in three places, it's not saved. I know that's a lot. I will stick by it forever. If you do not have it saved in three places, it's not saved and you will have the possibility of losing it. So keep that in mind. I do two SD cards. So there's one and two and then a hard drive. So that's my three. I just recently started Backblaze too. So now I have four. So I always shoot for weddings on dual slots. So I have the same picture saved on two SD cards. I back them up onto a hard drive the minute I get home from a wedding, if not at the wedding. Those are the three places that I store. And then you can also do online backups like the cloud or whatever. I use Backblaze because it's cheap and it's unlimited storage and it just automatically backs up all the time. So yeah, solid state drives versus hard drives. I want to show you guys solid state drives. I will forever be into photographers' heads. You should be using solid state drives because they don't spin like a hard drive. Okay. Hard drives spin, and if that spinning breaks, you corrupt all your data. These guys, they're very expensive, sucks, just get used to it, are called solid state drives. They don't spin. They are much less likely to corrupt on you. The only one thing, the downside of these is that sometimes they get really hot if you're moving big files, but if you have it on a desk, you're going to be fine. So yes, that's solid state drive. These are the ones that are so common that photographers use. These ones. Throw them away and never buy them. I've had way too many corrupts on me. So every time I see a photographer with them, I will blast them for it. Don't buy them. Okay. Let's see. Storage and backing up. So this is my process. I save the raw photos from my SD card onto a hard drive. Then I cull my favorite images. So I save the ones that are my favorites. I still keep all the raw files all the time, but I'm culling them. I import my favorites to Lightroom. Then I use smart previews in Lightroom so that I can edit. We talked about that a couple weeks ago, I think. Save my final JPEG images back to the hard drive in a different folder. So I know the ones that have been edited versus the raw files. And then upload them to my gallery delivery service, deliver them to my client. And then I let them know, okay, your gallery is expiring whenever. Make sure you download them before that. I have them archived or I'll have them saved for 2 months or whatever your contract states that you're going to save them. And if they don't have them saved before then, you're allowed to delete them. Now, do I ever delete pictures? rarely do I ever delete for storage. I have a million hard drives with backed up photos. But they need to know that it's not your responsibility after that. So make sure it's in your contract. Okay, I'm gonna stop the recording and then I'll have you guys see if you have any questions. Let's see.